Early that day. I was young then, feeling half and out. And mother hanging out of the window in her nightdress, weeping and waving. Nice fresh morning, bright, too early as so often, feeling really awful, very violent. Sky would soon darken and rain fall and go on falling all day till evening, and then blue and sun again the second. Then night. Feeling all this, how violent and the kind of day I stopped and turned. So back with bowed head on the lookout for a snail, slug or worm. Great love in my heart too for all things still and rooted. Bushes. Boulders and the like. Too numerous to mention. Even the flowers of the field, not for the world, when in my right senses will I ever touch one to pluck it. Whereas a bird now or a butterfly fluttering about and getting in my way, all moving things getting in my path, a slug now getting under my feet. No, no, mercy. Not that I'd go out of my way to get at them. No. At a distance often they seem still. Then a moment later they were upon me. Birds. With my piercing sight I have seen flying so high. So far that they seemed at rest. And the next minute they were all about me. Crows have done this. Ducks are perhaps the worst. To be suddenly stamping and stumbling in the midst of ducks. Or hens. Any class of poultry, few things are worse. Nor will I go out of my way to avoid such things when avoidable. No, I simply will not go out of my way. Though I have never in my life been on my way anywhere, but simply on my way. And in this way I have gone through great thickets, bleeding, deep into bogs, water too, even the sea in some moods, and been carried out of my course or driven back so as not to drown. Perhaps that's how I shall die at last, if they don't catch me. I mean drowned. Or in fire. Yes, perhaps that's how I shall do it. Walking furious, headlong into fire and dying burnt to bits. Then I raised my eyes and saw my mother still in the window waving me back around. I don't know, just waving in sad, helpless love. And I heard faintly her cries. The window frame was green, pale, and the house wall grey, and my mother white, so thin I could see past her. Piercing sight I had then, into the dark of the room, and on all that full and not long risen sun, and all small because of the distance, very pretty, really, the whole thing, I remember it, the old grey, and then the thin green surround, and the thin white against the dark. If only she could have been still and let me look at it all. No, for once I wanted to stand and look at something. I couldn't with her there, waving and fluttering and swaying in and out of the window as though she were doing exercises. And for all I know, she may have been not bothering about me at all. No tenacity or purpose. That was another thing I didn't like in her. One week it would be exercises, the next prayers and Bible reading, the next gardening, the next playing the piano and singing. That was awful. And then just lying about and resting, always changing. Not that it mattered to me, I was always out. But let me get on now with the day I have hit on to begin with. Any other would have done as well. Yes, on Mrs. Nelson, my way and on to another. Enough of my mother. For the moment. Well then, for a time all well, no trouble, no birds at me, nothing across my path. Except at a great distance, a white horse followed by a boy. Or it might have been a small man or woman. Now this is the only completely white horse I remember. What I believe the Germans call a Schimmel. Oh, I was very quick as a boy and picked up a lot of hard knowledge. Schimmel. Nice word for an English speaker. The sun was full upon it, as shortly before, on my mother, and it seemed to have a red band or stripe running down its side. I thought perhaps a belly band. Perhaps the horse was going somewhere to be harnessed to a trap or such like. It crossed my path a long way off, then vanished behind greenery, I suppose. All I noticed was the sudden appearance of the horse, then disappearance. It was bright white with the sun on it. I had never seen such a horse, though often heard of them, and never saw another. White, I must say, has always affected me strongly. All white things, sheets, walls, and so on. Even flowers, and then just white, the thought of white without more. But let me get on with this day and get this over. All well then for a time, just the violins and then this white horse. When suddenly I flew into a most savage rage, really blinding. Now why this sudden rage, I really don't know. These sudden rages made my life a misery. Many other things too did this. My sore throat, for example. I have never known what it is to be without a sore throat. But the rage has got it worst, like a great wind suddenly rising in me. No, I can't describe. It wasn't the violence getting worse in any case, nothing to do with that. Some days I'd be feeling violent all day and never have a rage. Other days quite quiet for me, have 4 or 5. No, there's no accounting for it. There's no accounting for anything. There's a mind like the one I always had, always on the alert against itself. I'll come back on this perhaps when I feel less weak. There was a time I tried to get relief by beating my head against something, but I gave it up. The best thing I found was to start running. Perhaps I should mention here that I was a very slow walker. I didn't dally or loiter in any way, just walked very slowly. Did a short step and the feet very slow through the air. On the other hand, I must have been quite one of the fastest runners the world has ever seen. Over a short distance, 5 or 10 yards. In the second I was there, because I could not go on at that speed, not for breathlessness. It was mental. All is mental, figments. Now the jog trot, on the other hand, I could no more do that than I could fly. No, with me all was slow, and then these flashes or gushes, vent the pent. That was one of those things I used to say over and over as I went along. Vent the pent. Vent the pent. Fortunately, my father died when I was a boy. Otherwise, I might have been a professor. He had set his heart on it. A very fair scholar I was too. No thought was a great memory. One day I told him about Milton's cosmology. Away up in the mountains we were resting against a huge rock looking out to sea. That impressed him greatly. Love too often in my thoughts when a boy. But not a great deal compared to other boys. It kept me awake, I found. Never loved anyone, I think, I remember. Except in my dreams. And there it was animals. Dream animals. Nothing like to see walking about the country. I couldn't describe them. Lovely creatures they were. White, mostly. In a way, perhaps it is a pity. A good woman might have been the making of me. I might be sprawling in the sun now, sucking my pipe, patting the bottoms of the next generation. Looked up to and respected. Wondering what there was for dinner. Instead of stravaguing the same old roads and all weathers. I was never much of a one for new ground. No. I regret nothing. All I regret is having been born. Dying is such a long and tiresome business, I always found. But let me get on now from where I left off. The white horse and then the rage. No connection, I suppose. But why go on with all this? I don't know. Someday I must end, why not now? But these are thoughts, not mine, no matter shame upon me. All this talking, no wonder I had a sore throat. Perhaps I should mention here that I never talked to anyone. I think my father was the last one I talked to. My mother was the same. Never talked. Never answered since my father died. I asked her for the money. I can't go back on that now. Those must have been my last words to her. Sometimes she cried out to me or implored, but never long, just a few cries. Then if I looked up, the poor old thin lips pressed tight together and the body turned away. And just the corners of the eyes on me. But it was rare. Sometimes in the night I heard her talking to herself, I suppose, or playing out loud, or reading out loud, or reciting our hymns. Poor woman. Well, after the horse and the rage, I don't know, it was gone. Then I suppose the slow turn, reading more and more to the one or other hand, and facing home, then home. Ah, my father and mother, to think they are probably in paradise. They were so good. Well, let me go to hell. That's all I ask. And go on cursing them there. Yes, I believe all that blather about the life to come. It cheers me up. And unhappiness like mine. There's no annihilating that. I was mad, of course. And still am. But harmless. I passed for harmless. That's a good one. Not, of course, that I was really mad. Just strange. A little strange. But every passing year, a little stranger. There could be few stranger creatures going about than me at the present day. My father. Did I kill him too, as well as my mother? Perhaps in a way I did. But I can't come into that now. It's too old and weak. The questions float up as I go along and leave me very confused. Breaking up I am. Suddenly they are there. No, they float up better in old depth and hover and linger before they die away. Questions that when I was in my right mind would not have survived 1 second. No, but atomized they would have been before as much as formed. Atomized. In twos, often they came, one harder than the other. Thus, how shall I go on another day, and then how did I ever go on another day, or did I kill my father, and then did I ever kill anyone that kind of way, from the general to the particular, I suppose you might say, question and answer to it. Very addling. I strive at them as best I can, quickening my step when they come on, tossing my head from side to side, and up and down, staring agonizedly at this and that, and facing my murmur to a scream. These are helps. But they should not be necessary now. Something is wrong here. If it was not the end, I would not so much mind, but how often have I said in my life that it is the end? And it was not the end. And yet the end cannot be far off now. I shall fall as I go along and stay down or curl up for the night as usual among the rocks and before morning be gone. Oh, I know. I too shall cease and be as when I was not yet, only all over instead of in store. That makes me happy. Often now my murmur falters and dies, and I weep for happiness as I go along, and for the love of this old earth that has carried me so long, and whose uncomplainingness will soon be mine. Just under the surface I shall be, all together at first, then separate and drift through all the earth, and perhaps in the end through a cliff into the sea, something of me. A ton of worms in an acre, that is a wonderful thought. A ton of worms, I believe it. Where did I get it? From a dream? Or a book read in a nook when a boy? Or a word overheard as I went along, or in me all along and kept under till it could give me joy? These are the kind of horrid thoughts I have to contend with in the way I have said. Now, is there nothing to add to this day with the white horse and white mother in the window? No, all has gone. But mother in the window, the violence, the rage and rain. So on to the second day and get us over and out of the way and on to the next. What happens now is I was set on and pursued by a family, or tribe, I do not know, of stoats. A most extraordinary thing. I think they were stoats. Indeed, if I may say so, I think I was fortunate to get off with my life. Strange expression. Does not sound right somehow. Anyone else would have been bitten and bled to death, perhaps sucked white like a rabbit. There is that word, white again. I know I could never think, but if I could have and then had, I would have just lain down and let myself be destroyed as the rabbit does. But let me start, as always, with the morning and the getting out. When the day comes back, whatever the reason, then it's morning and it's evening, two are there. Though in themselves quite unremarkable, the going out and coming home. There's a remarkable thing, I find. So up then in the grey of dawn, very weak and shaky after an atrocious night, little dreaming what lay in store. Out and off. What time of year? I really do not know. Does it matter? Not wet really, but dripping. Everything dripping. The day might rise, did it now? Drip, drip all day long, no sun, no change of light, dim all day and still not a breath till night, and black and a little wind. I saw some stars as I neared home. My stick, of course, by a merciful providence. I shall not say this again, will not mention. My stick is in my hand as I go along, but not my long coat, just my jacket. I could never bear the long coat flapping about my legs. Or rather, one day suddenly I turned against it, a sudden violent dislike. Often when dressed to go, I would take it out and put it on, then stand in the middle of the room, unable to move, until at last I could take it off and put it back in its hanging the cord. So I was hardly down the stairs and out into the air when the stick just fell from my hand and I just sank to my knees to the ground and then forward on my face. Most extraordinary thing, and then after a little over on my back. I could never lie on my face for any length of time. Much as I loved it, it made me feel sick. Lay there half an hour perhaps with my arms along my sides and the palms of my hands against the pebbles, and my eyes wide open, straying over the sky. Now, was this my first experience of this kind? That is the question that immediately you say as well. Falls I had had, and plenty of the kind, after which, unless a limb broken, you pick yourself up and go on cursing God and man. very different from this. With so much life gone from knowledge, how know when all began? All the variants of the one. But one by one, the venom staling follow upon one another all life long till you succumb. So in some way, even olden things each time are first things. No two breaths the same, all are going over and over, and all once and never more. There is a soft place in my heart for all that is over, for the being over, I love the world. Words have been my only loves, not many. Often as I went along, I have said it, Overo, Overo. The third day was the look I got from the road man. Suddenly I see that now, the ragged old brute bent double down in the ditch, leaning on his spade, or whatever it was, and leering round and up at me from under the brim of his slouch and the red mouth. How it is, I wonder I saw him at all. That is more like it. The day I saw the look I got from Balf. I went in terror of him as a child. Now he is dead. And I resemble him. Well, once out on the road and free from the property, what then? I really don't know. The next thing I was up on the bracken, lashing about with my stick, making the drops fly and cursing. Filthy language. Same words over and over. I hope nobody heard me. Choked very bad, to swallow was torment, and something wrong with an ear. I kept poking at it without relief. Old wax, perhaps, pressing on the drum. Extraordinary still over the land, and in me too all quite still. A coincidence. Why the curses were pouring out of me, I do not know. And the lashing about with a stitch. What possessed me, mild and weak, to be doing that as I struggled along? Is it the stoats now? No. First I just sink down and disappear in the ferns. Up to my waist they were, as I went along. Harsh things, these great ferns. Like starched, very woody. Terrible stalks, take the skin off your legs, through your trousers. And then the holes they hide. Break your leg if you're not careful. Fall and vanish from view. You could lie there for weeks and no one would hear you. I often pause at that up in the mountains. No, that is a foolish thing to say. Just went on. My body doing its best without me. Without